a difficult time for the country and everybody else, but we appreciate that you were able to come. My name is Jacob Mafumi, I'm the spokesperson of the MDC. We are here with the leadership, the president, Advocate Nelson Chamisa, will lead the press conference by reading out the statement, clarify a few things, and also answer a few questions. We are going into our Congress. Without preempting the press conference, I'll ask the president to begin the proceedings.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I want to thank you for coming at a very short notice. Just to indicate to you that today we had our national leadership meeting, the National Standing Committee. And the National Standing Committee of the party is the most superior board of the party. As a subcommittee of the National Executive, of course, under the management of the National Council. So we had occasion to reflect on the developments in the country and developments in the party, and with the following statement to make. But before I go to this statement, I just want to acknowledge all the leaders here present. As you can see, this is the leadership that is there on behalf of the party. Vice President Mzuri here present, Vice President Komichi, Vice President Professor Nwe, our chairperson is in the UK, Tabitha Kumalo. We have our Vice Chairperson, Honorable Tedai Biti. We have our Secretary General, Honorable Douglas Togarase Monzora. We have our Deputy Secretary General, Honorable Bariwa. We have our Treasurer General, Honorable Teresa Makoni. We have our Deputy Treasurer General in Police Sales, in absentia, Charles Rwende. We have our Organizing Secretary, Comrade Chibaya. Our Deputy Organizing Secretary, Baba, Dr. Beke Esmanda. We have our spokesperson here present, Comrade Mafume, and the Deputy Spokesperson, Dr. Ektemba Mpofu, Senator, and we have our Secretary for Elections, Comrade Murisi Dubai. We also have our Secretary for Women's Affairs and the Chairperson of the Women, Honorable Kore, in blue, heaven colors. We have Comrade Chidziwa, who is also our leader and Chairperson of the Youth Assembly. So that does it for leadership. This is just the National Standing Committee, not the National Executive. The Executive has 84 members. The National Council has over 300 members. That's the party for it. Ladies and gentlemen, let me just say that the crisis in our country is escalating. The effects of the legitimacy crisis and the legitimacy question continue to arrest the people of Zimbabwe, and calls for genuine dialogue seem to be falling on deaf ears. We have started this dialogue call. It has been hijacked to divert it to pursue another agenda and another motive, which has nothing to do with the resolution of the fundamental issues affecting Zimbabweans. Some may want to know what, according to us, is the nature of the crisis. The nature of the crisis is that it is a crisis of government. It is a leadership crisis. It is a crisis of governance, which crisis can only be resolved when there is confidence, when there is trust in the country. Until this is resolved, the political stalemate shall continue to erode our prospect to have an economic narrative that will respond to the demands of our people in Zimbabwe. So let us understand the nature of the crisis that we are facing. Let us also understand the things that have to be resolved. Because people seem to forget that the national question, the national dilemma, the national quagmire is a quagmire of a disputed election on the 30th of July, which is a crisis of governance. You are clear that we are seeing the reincarnation of yesteryear politics, of closure of democratic space. We have also seen the consolidation of force and coercion, tyranny in the new state. The so-called new republic has clearly shown that it is a fluke. It is a ruse for the people of Zimbabwe. There is a continuation of the old order of economic lethargy, economic destruction, corruption, patronage, and the decay and decomposition of the state. The people's plight seems to be worsening. There is a relentless order of poverty and the devaluation of our people and people's lives and values. Inequality continues, the haves and the have-nots, and gaps are widening, and there's also continued destruction of life, including the kind of destruction that we've seen, which is almost like Murambachina Part 2. The behavior of formalized rent-seeking transactions by the elite continue to take center stage. You are aware of what is happening, especially after the monetary policy which was announced, which has caused the following problems. Particular illegal forfeiture of foreign currency and the values of people, the issue of state-sponsored rent-seeking service platforms in which political elites seem to have access more than any other on certain of the RBZ 1:1 rates stipulated in terms of Section 43 of the RBZ Act. We have also seen the fact that the interbank platform that has been put is also proving to be a bit of a problem, particularly through the creation of a self-initiated inflationary environment. We also see that the floating of the RTGS dollar, which is quite problematic because we don't know the currency we are using. We had the bond, now we have the RTGS dollar. We don't know what the RTGS coins are going to be, how they are going to be designated. That deliberate devaluation of the people's lives and values is something that we take and take seriously. In short, you've also seen that the monetary policy blew an opportunity to just resolve the fundamental questions. We have offered as the alternative to say, in order for us to move forward, you need to restore confidence, you need to restore trust, but to restore trust, you also need to have smart economic measures. We have offered those measures to Mr. Mnangagwa and his team. We hope that they were going to be good people to learn good ideas, but we've seen that they are neglecting and ignoring those alternative ideas we are putting. But what is most important and fundamental is for us to resolve the crisis of governance, which is at the core of our problem. So the plight of our people continues to be worsening. You have seen the price of bread is also gone up. We have seen queues are resurfacing, but we have also seen the shortage of money in the banks, which is a problem. We have also seen on the political stage the clampdown of MDC members. At least 70 people from our records have been killed in the January disturbances. Beyond that, we have also seen a systematic targeting of strong MDC leaders, MPs, councillors, and also leaders of the trade union movement, the CTU and the civic society, who have been targeted. There has been invasion of homes, abductions, arbitrary arrests, mass and fast-tracked trials, which to some extent are a negation of what we believe to be the character of rule of law. The level of human rights violations is worsening by the day. We have seen Honorable Senator Morgan Komich, Honorable Tendai Biti MP, Honorable Charlton Wenge MP, Honorable Amos Chibaya MP, Hepmo Chidziwa MP, Godfrey Stole MP, Levi Chimina MP, Lloyd Mkapiko MP, Settlement Chikwinya MP, Joanna Mamombe MP, who have all been brought before the courts on charges that we believe to be trumped up. We have seen that Zimbabwe has gone further down in terms of indicators in democracy and freedom worldwide. That failure to live by minimum standards has attracted isolation of the country. A case in point, the measures we have seen being implemented by the EU, by the United States of America, which are in fact self-inflicted. we would want to get out of a situation where we have this kind of animosity, but we can only do so once we correct and chlorinate our domestic front in the country. We make a key point for reforms as a way to locate exit points to the crisis affecting our country. And this is why we have emphasized the issue of dialogue. And on dialogue, we have clearly stated that we are prepared for dialogue anytime, any hour with Mr. Mnangagwa on the pertinent issues. I don't understand why he's afraid of a genuine dialogue, face to face, brow to brow, eyebrow to eyebrow. Then we discuss the issues affecting the country. Once we resolve, we then move forward. We wrote to them on the 5th of... On the 6th of February, we wrote to Mr. Mnangagwa's office to say we are not interested in participating in a caucus of people who are like-minded. Mr. Mnangagwa and his team of other candidates who participated in the election. We said we want all the people to come, but after having resolved the fundamental issue, the dispute between Mr. Mnangagwa and ourselves. Once we have resolved that, we can then try to have an inclusive dialogue, but with an understanding of what we need to cure. You can't have dialogue without knowing what you need to address or cure. So we've put issues that are supposed to be given as indicators and signals of sincerity, as markers of genuineness on the part of Mr. Mnangagwa. On our part, we've done everything within our power, and this is why our diplomatic outreach is aimed at making sure that we make SADC and the African Union realize that the problem in Zimbabwe can only be resolved once we've attacked dictatorship, attacked tyranny, attacked manipulation of elections, and of course, a disputed election. We've, however, realized that there is a sideshow that has been disguised as a dialogue. But we also see that a lot of other leaders are deserting that one because they realize that it's not a legitimate platform to resolve issues affecting Zimbabweans. Our circumstances demand political dialogue as of yesterday. Zimbabweans are suffering and they need an answer to their issues. We need to find a lasting solution. You saw the situation at Battlefield where our people were entrapped and died on account of negligence, on account of lack of capacity on the part of government. If it was our government, we would not have allowed that kind of a thing. Within hours, we must have emergency measures to respond to issues affecting the government. Not to spend hours without responding to an issue. After you do that, you go to a rally. You can't go fishing when the house is on fire. So that is our narrative in the authority. Now, I want to take you to our next issue, which is basically the state of the MDC. The MDC is going into its Congress, the 5th Congress, after the passing on of the founding president, Dr. Richard Morgan Tsvangirai. I must indicate that this is our 5th Congress. We've had our first Congress, second Congress, third Congress, fourth Congress. Now this is the 5th one. I've heard a lot of people indicating negative messages to say, no, the MDC is going to emerge weaker. This is a giant that will emerge stronger. The party is on the move. This party is unshakable and unshaken. The People's Party is very strong. This year we are celebrating 20 years of existence. We have had 2 decades of fighting dictatorship, 2 decades of resisting tyranny, 2 decades of trying to bring an alternative to our country. The party has managed to emerge victorious in all the elections we have participated in. And of course, we acknowledge the fact that the recent election, we saw the good showing of our party at the president, and also the good showing of our party in our local authorities, where we are in charge in governing of 28 cities and towns out of the 32. Our colleagues in ZANU-PF are not the government in local authority. We are the government. We are the leading government. And you know that we are the party that the people believe in terms of delivering change to them. We have the issue of the movement, which has been re-energized and revived. There's no doubt that we've united the party. We've revitalized the party. That's why you see Mr. Beat here, you see Professor Nguye here, you see many other faces that are coming together because we've managed to reboot and revitalize the organization, engendering zeal and enthusiasm for change and also igniting the hopes of many in Zimbabwe and Africa as a continent and beyond. We've soared above limitations and extended far beyond the expectations of many, their expectations and defying all the odds. You are aware of the outstanding performance that we have just done. We've made giant leaps. We are a leading party. We are also in charge of our mayors who are doing a fantastic job. Some of them, of course, need to improve their circumstances, but we are happy that we are gaining ground across the whole country. Our competitors, ANPF, is losing ground. People are losing confidence because they didn't have any. And this is why our credibility is important in terms of the dialogue so that we deal with the discredited circumstances of ZANU-PF. You are aware, if you are honest, that we got 2.6 million, but if you are dishonest, you will say we got 2.1 million. But all the same, that kind of showing is a serious showing. We attracted members from the opposite side, including some prominent and eminent ones, which is no mean feat. It is a great achievement. Those who want to govern always have to go across the board and fish from rivers across. We did that and we are doing that even more. As you may know, the party now governs in the local authorities and will continue to govern in a proper manner and different. Now, why is this Congress very important? This is a very important Congress because it is our opportunity to have a full team of effective leadership as we prepare to take over government in a democratic and constitutional manner. It also gives us a chance to have a solid team of people of substance. You can see the faces of substance, but obviously those faces have to be renewed. And this is why we are going into this election. And this is why I've said I'm the first one to congratulate and celebrate the one who is going to emerge out of this glorious activity, out of this glorious Congress. I know they may not have shown their interest because in our part, it is actually not allowed by the Constitution to show interest. You are deployed as a cadre. People choose you to belong to a particular position. So you don't just say, you are wanted by the people. So it is a process which is rigorous and very democratic, where people are nominated by the lower structures to say we want so and so to be president, we want so and so to be vice president, so and so to be chairperson, and the list goes on. So that process is coming as I will articulate. So yes, this is a moment to have a team of substance. It is also a moment to reflect on the new dynamism that the party is thrust upon. We also have a duty to set the new standards in the politics of our country and an opportunity to have a fresh set of energized troops and also creating a platform for a new culture, a new structure, new infrastructure, new systems, new institutions, new ideas, new strategies and new tactics. That is the course we are taking. And that's why in terms of just the thrust of our Congress team, the theme of our Congress is defining a new course for Zimbabwe. The 5th Congress of the MPC is about defining a new course for this country. And we are indeed going to define a new course. It's not going to be the game as usual or music as usual. After the Congress, Mr. Mnangagwa must be ready. He must be ready for us. He must be ready because we are going to renew and retool the party for the greater task to take over the responsibility of governing in a constitutional manner. The time, of course, we'll have to articulate when the time comes. We'll also show the world that MDC is not just a consumer of democracy, but a producer of democracy. We are the MDC and we are not ZANU-PF. Democracy and democratic conduct is part of our totem, it's part of our name. It runs in our blood. Change is our lifestyle. Change is our fashion. That's why we are not scared of change. So yes, we are going to have a lot of changes in terms of the propositional values and also in terms of the positional outline that we are going to have in the Youth Assembly, in the Women's Assembly, but also in the Veterans Assembly. So we embolden our representation of the liberation fighters so that we take our part back into issues of the liberation struggle and angering our struggles in our yesteryear struggle. So we must understand that as we go to Congress, tensions are likely to run high. It's going to be choppy, tough, and exciting. Leaders are encouraged to exercise patience. We must not exchange blows in an undemocratic manner. We've also said as leadership, we're not going to accept these declarations typical of ZANU-PF. We are not ZANU-PF, we don't have declarations. We have nominations and they will be announced as and when the time comes. We appreciate individual opinions. We appreciate assemblies having their own opinions, but we don't want those opinions to be the basis of intimidating others who may be weak-kneed, lily-livered, or jelly-kneed. So we want to make sure that democracy is there for all of us. Democracy is there for those who may also wish to be considered for the leadership contest. Mr. Chamisa is not the last born of this democratic field, and he is also not the first born. There was the founder, Dr. Richard Morgan Tsvangirai. He's not there. He groomed leaders. He did not groom one. Yes, I'm one of them, but we are many of them who were groomed by this great icon. And that's why we celebrate and we know that this movement is going to be in safe hands, capable hands, at any given point in time. In fact, we have proved to ZANU-PF that by killing Dr. Richard Morgan Tsvangirai, they probably made a mistake. The party is even going to go to new levels, because we are charting a new course. They thought that the party was going to collapse by elimination of our boss, but the party is even energizing and recalibrating. Yes, we don't want to see dictatorship in our structures, tyranny in our structures, violence in our structures. Those are things we see next door in ZANU-PF. We cannot be a carbon copy of ZANU-PF, where factionalism is a national religion, where unpatriotic politics is a daily practice, where corruption is the DNA, and where careerism has almost become common practice in this former Liberation Party. We are MDC, and we can't do that which we are running away from, or seek to emulate that we seek to dismantle. That is dictatorship. The path to progress is only going to be realized by the way this Congress is going to be conducted. And we can assure you that we will have the best Congress ever. We have instituted an independent electoral body that is going to be in charge of the electoral process, so that we don't have insiders who are expressing their own interests. So yes, that body is going to be constituted, and all the leaders are going to be part of the coming up with that body, so that there is no crime or foul. We don't want to reproduce a ZEC within our own ranks. We want things to be done above board in a proper manner and according to the dictates of democracy. We are the biggest party in the country. As you may know, peace, tolerance, maturity, and robustness in all our campaigns is a quality that we are going to see and would encourage. We dare not elect leaders who are going to disappoint, and this is why we have said in our consultation we have to come up with a Congress roadmap. And Comrade Chibaya is going to read out to you some of the key dates that we have indicated. In fact, I can do that for you. I can see you are not ready. We must make sure that in all our Congress templates, we pass the constitutional test of the MDC membership in terms of our democratic scrutiny, in terms of our democratic practice. The democracy meal is painful, but we all have to go through it. Our agenda is to grow this party. Our agenda is to grow the base. Our agenda is to fish across the rivers from the other political parties and to make sure that MDC is a broad church of all Zimbabweans from all diverse backgrounds and shades of opinion. We've succeeded in doing that. Being a social democratic labor-backed party, we seek to cement and consolidate our Pan-African flair, locate our liberation struggle roots, our nationalistic appeal being fomented, and also the National Democratic Revolution being advanced, standing on the shoulders of freedom fighters, our war veterans, and their liberation narrative. Yes, we know that we are in a very violent environment, but we will resist the temptation to use violence as a way of transacting politics. We are a vibrant party. That's why you see the kind of debate that you see. It is quite reminiscent of circumstances where you have such a very powerful party. You have seen leaders expressing their views in newspapers. We have since said we will not allow our leaders to all be spokespersons on the Congress. There's going to be one spokesperson on the Congress, and that's what is spokesperson. All the other leaders are going to be spokespersons of themselves as they campaign quietly and according to the Congress template. So yes, the leaders are very clear. They know that when we have rules, they are meant to be observed and not to be broken. When you break rules, you are also inviting challenges to yourself, because law is meant to punish those who do not obey it. And that is what will happen if we do not obey the law. So yes, we'll campaign in a very proper manner. As I have indicated, with our own Congress roadmap, the key dates and the key processes are like this. We are going to have, in the month of March, our branch elections and the ward elections. As we go into the month of April, we are going to be doing our district assemblies. That's the district congresses. But of course, beyond the end of, towards the end of April, we will be having our provincial congresses. Now, once we begin to have provincial congresses, we now are beginning to have nominations. Because nominations are done at a provincial congress in a democratic manner. The province that chooses a particular candidate should have the highest number of those delegates to a provincial congress, you know, indicating that they want a particular candidate. Once we have finished, those who are nominated are now due to then be introduced into a gango, Rajivuti gango, a democratic pan, where you have to be tested, where you go into an election. Then you have to say, no, I'm nicer than this, than that. And that's now the process after nominations. People don't self-nominate in this party. People are nominated by lower organs in a democratic manner. Away from the typical ZANU-PF fashion where people are endorsed, we do democratic elections, nominations. Then after those nominations, we go to May. May is set aside for the what we are calling caucuses for campaigns or beauty contests. Our organizing department, that's according to the template, will then introduce all the nominated candidates for a particular position to go and campaign to the membership. Both those who are Congress delegates and those who are just members of the MDC, so that they articulate what they are able to do. Because you can be nominated, but you'll be clueless. Like my brother who was elected and now he's struggling because he's self-elected, you know. Into a position. I will not mention who, but you know. So we don't want leaders who are nominated and they are not able to then live up to the task in terms of what we want to see. So yes, that's the process. We have a full month of campaigns and those focuses at district level, at provincial level, and once that is done, we are ready for our Congress on the 24th to the 26th of May. The venue is to be announced. We are making a couple of considerations, but we've also dealt with the issue of the Youth Assembly and Women's Assembly, their congresses, that are going to precede the National Congress. That's on the 23rd. We are a part of excellence, and we don't expect any problems. We are so happy that the ship is going to sail smoothly. The MDC is not capable of splitting. Yes, leaders will always join and unjoin, but it doesn't mean that the party will split. Yes, it will exfoliate, peeling off the outer layer for renewal purposes. But this party is not capable of splitting because the people can't split. It is a people's project, so you can't split this project. So don't worry. It's not as if we have a crisis of the pilots. As you can see, the pilots are ready. Some are even ready to be principal pilots. It's allowed because it's a democratic party. As you can see, it's allowed. You can see their foreheads, yes, they are. That's democracy for you. And it's allowed, there's nothing wrong with people wanting to be chosen, also to save their glorious movement. That's what democracy is all about. And we want to do our best to make sure that we teach ZANU-PF what real democracy is like and how leaders are democratically chosen. Yes, I've said we want to grow the base. As I always say, we grow by adding and where necessary by multiplying or multiplication. We never grow by dividing or subtracting. That's why we felt so sad when our sister Kupe chose to run away. But look at where she is now. She's now swimming in dangerous waters, including those infested by crocodiles. But the most important thing for us is to make sure that we always get our people together so that we're able to build a formidable party and remain focused on the goal so that that which is uniting us is far exceeding that which may separate us. Together we shine. Apart and asunder, we are all dust and very weak. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Are there any questions on the issues I have articulated? I know it was a bit long, but I just wanted to try and touch on the issues so that you are answered. Comrade Shibai, I hope I've exhausted, Comrade SG, I've exhausted the key aspects on the conventional preparation.
Well, I guess most agrees with the sitting leader, probably I would say, his level is unfair. Is that your personal view? That when somebody disagrees or wishes to challenge you, is this labeled as unfair?
Well, it depends on who is labeling and what they are labeling for.
In your personal view?
In my view, I don't believe in label and condemn. You don't label a competitor in order to condemn them. You condemn them by making sure that you show your credentials that are better than them. And you don't campaign by words, you campaign by action. So that people know. In fact, by now, people are very clear about who is able to do what. We don't need to come to people to say we are able to do this, because we have had 5 years of our credentials. And we don't need name calling, it's not part of our practice. If there is any name calling, it is untoward and out of place. And I've already said to leaders, there are do's and don'ts in campaigns. And they know. I'm very clear about what I've said. You must know that the organization assumes the character of its leader. So it's important for the leader to make sure that there's a promotion of peace, there's promotion of tolerance, there's also a diversity of opinions. But of course, political banter is something that we will not take seriously and will not take it in the course of our politics. I hope you answered. Thank you very much. Yes, Comrade Lamina of the Herald. A big man.
Thank you very much. Is the standing committee resolved each of which positions are going to be contested? There were varied interpretations on which or how many number of positions are contested. Some would say only four, others would say all 16. Is it resolved?
There is no varied interpretation. There is varied listenership on your part. You want to listen differently to different leaders. We have said this Congress is about positions that are going to be available. In terms of the actual positions to be contested through a direct election and some being appointed, is something to be determined by the National Council at our penultimate meeting, the meeting that we'll have just before the Congress. And that is going to then guide. In terms of our constitution, we are supposed to have the presidium being open to contestation, the chairman's position being open to contestation. There's still debate on the Secretary General's position being open to contestation. But again, that is a product of our internal democratic processes. So don't worry, there's no valid interpretation. You will see, we will be very clear on which positions are to be nominated appropriately and at the appropriate time. Any questions, Comrade Lama? I can see you are smiling, yes?
Okay, away from that. You so-called diplomatic offensive appear to be shrouded in some silence. In other words, information dissemination collapsed soon after we left.
Well, I don't know why you are already being adjectival and characterizing my diplomatic visit as the so-called. It's not so-called, it is a diplomatic offense. But what we've said is that we will never whisper in the ear of ZANU-PF on our strategy. They should not be interested in knowing who we meet and what we do. But far from it, I mean, the fact that Mr. Chamisa had gone to a pastoral conference, the next day they wake up to say he had gone to consult voters. I don't do what they do, consulting Ngangas and Sambomas. I don't do that. I'm a man of God. And I consult God, I don't consult other men when I want to have answers to national problems or personal problems. So that's the difference. Don't worry about that. We will announce as and when time comes. This is a diplomatic outreach. There are protocols in diplomacy. You don't just shout from the top of the mountain as if you are in a village visit. There are protocols to be followed. And we can't be forced by ZANU-PF to tell them and review where we've gone. When AD goes to Russia, does he tell me who he meets? So why does he want to know my friends? To bewitch them.
Thank you very much. My name is Philemon Nyangaya from Zimbabwe Morning Post. I wanted to check, how do you feel since the announcement of the Congress dates, ZANU-PF have been saying that they want this candidate to lead the MDC. Yesterday, Govets also spoke to the media telling us whom they want to lead the MDC. Do you feel that their hand might be on play during this period?
We're so excited. When the big man is playing, everyone watches. So the fact that we're going to a Congress and there's a lot of interest from ZANU-PF tells us that we are the big guy. They are interested in the MDC because we are setting a new course for Zimbabwe. And they are doing very well. They realize that their future is not where they are, but where they are opposing.
Do you think that their hand might be visible?
Look, we've had the ZANU-PF hand in our meetings, but that hand has always been a weak hand. And we'll make it even weaker in this Congress. Yes?
Can you comment on the issue of the 6 million set aside for destabilizing MDC through the Congress?
Well, look, they can. We know that they are always, when it comes to power retention, ZANU-PF is legendary. They can set funds, they can set whatever. We're not interested in that. What we want in this country is to make sure that we resolve the national crisis. This whole thing is not going to affect us. The people in the MDC are not foolish. They know what they want, and they expect all these leaders, so they will choose their leadership. In fact, you can see that we don't have a crisis of leadership. Some who put on heads, some who wear wine beard, some who are gold-headed, you know. So, you know, so we have a red leadership, and we don't have a crisis of leadership in the MPC. We are not shaken, we are not worried. They can do all the things they want to do. The only unfortunate thing is that they must not have man set aside to destroy their salvation. They must destroy poverty. They must be able to have this kind of money for people out there in the rural areas who want food, who want drought relief. Let us take the 6 million to hospitals in the rural areas, not to bring money to MDC where it is not needed. It will be squandered. People who enjoy that money, after the Congress, they won't get the result that they're expecting, and they will start killing people. So we advise them to stop peeping into the MDC. They will have problems with their eyes.
Post from 2016. Just a follow-up to Jambai's question. In the run-up to presidential court challenge last year, Deputy Minister Matema Danda clearly stated that they preferred Secretary General Douglas Wonzora taking the reins of the party. You yourself and the party leadership, what do you make of such a statement?
Well, look, they want to try and divide us by thinking that they can choose one in our meeting. This is not a ZANU-PF Congress. This is an MDC Congress. Why are they showing preference of one candidate or the other? But I know that inside his heart, Matemadana actually prefers Chamisa. So don't listen seriously to what he says. He believes in the MPC. Matemadana, you know, I don't want to say much. He knows that we are the alternative. But if he continues to do what he's doing, I'll just show the video to prove that he believes and celebrates, even admires the MPC. That's why he's commenting a lot about us. But don't worry about that. We know. In our midst, we are a ready team, ready to charge. The fact that he has chosen to say, I love so-and-so, I prefer so-and-so, this is not a contest of preferences by ZANU-PF cadres who admire the MDC. It's an MDC congress where we are going to express who should be there. And we are so happy that this party is standing and is very strong. I tell you, my brother, this is the party to belong to. Yes, as a journalist, you can't belong to us, but this is the party to support. Yes.
You mentioned that Zimbabweans are suffering, and you also mentioned that there's a crackdown against your MPs. What action, specific action, are you taking about these issues?
Well, like I said, we are knocking on the doors of all the African leaders, President Cyril Ramaphosa included, to make the region and the continent realize and see that ours is a very serious situation. Apart from the crisis of legitimacy, we have a crisis of those who are in authority who are very cruel, and we need to stop this. Because MPs who are being targeted, ordinary members, citizens who are being targeted, some have had to sustain lifetime injuries and ailments. We need this issue to be resolved. So we are on a diplomatic engagement, but beyond that, we are also taking practical measures within the context of our political muscle we have to mobilize our people to defend ourselves in a constitutional manner.
Okay, Mr. Chamisa, I'm Fani Mofumo from the Morning Post. Last week, we've been seeing on Twitter most of the leadership that is with you there. They've been attacking certain individuals who are also with you there. What is it? You talked about punishment to those people who go around saying things about other leaders. But what is it that you're going to do as a party to punish the people? And what is, don't you think it's also going to divide the party when you leave some of the leaders that you have, name calling other leaders that you have in your camp?
Well, there is no division. Leaders may always say certain statements, but we are a part with protocols, with rules and regulations. We have had a meeting, we're in a meeting since morning. We discuss our issues. You will see and read my lips, look at my face. You will not see any such things going forward. If there are any such things where people are name calling, they will have crossed the line and there will be gnashing of teeth. And they know it. All the leaders are here, so it's not a threat. It's just a promise of what will happen if there is any crossing of the line. Because we are stewards, we are leaders on behalf of the people. It's not personal. You know, it's about the people. If we are to engage, we engage on the basis of ideas. We cross-pollinate on the basis of issues and not personality. So we are very clear on that. You don't see any such problem. Because we have not set the do's and don'ts, the template, issues that are supposed to be done. We are going to have campaigns in a free and fair manner. All these leaders you are seeing, yes, you can see they are very brave, but you know, Congress is not a good thing. There's Congress people, and they will all be thinking about where they are going to be. But at the end of the day, our people, the leaders in the MDC at lower levels, know what is good for this movement and what is good for Zimbabwe. So, don't worry about what you have seen. Very regrettable, but we've put a stop here.
Issued a statement telling the world that you're going on a joint mission.
Indeed.
It would be unfair for them now to keep guessing. From your horse's mouth, would you mind to share with them again the achievements you achieved in?
Yeah, sure.
It would be unfair for them to assume, to say, you want to see Nganga, like, probably. Would you mind to share, what do you see? Well, it's you who began the process.
We know our friends, we know our enemies. We are not in the business of answering every question, even if it is not a question.
But you raised it.
So if ZANU-PF, yes, I raised it. Do you want to hear? Or?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Thank you. What we have said is that those who are willing to know where we have gone will tell you at the appropriate time. We had a very successful diplomatic engagement. The results of the engagement are that our story is now understood. The people of Zimbabwe are supported by the fellow brothers and sisters on the African continent. And I must say that there's going to be a lot of support to the people of Zimbabwe to resolve their political issues. And you will see it. The story of rigged elections is well known. The story of dictatorship in Zimbabwe is now well known. And it's shared by men across the continent. So you will see the results of that diplomatic outreach very soon. And I can tell you, we will not divulge who we see at any given point in time unless if we feel it's necessary, because it becomes a matter of strategic importance. But I can tell you that we don't do diplomacy around Sangoma. That I can assure you. So there's no diplomacy around Sangoma. It's only those who believe that, I don't know where. But yes, if anything, we would actually go before our Father in heaven, our God, rather than failing. So thank you very much. On that, Polisa, I think I've given you a sharp answer.